The Bremen Drop Tower is a 140 meter high tower containing a 120 meter high vacuum chamber, which we are using to drop experiments under conditions of nearly perfect weightlessness. The tower consists of the drop shaft, deceleration chamber, a lot of vacuum pumps, and a catapult system which allows us to shoot the experiments from the bottom of the tower to the tip and then falling back again, doubling the microgravity time to nearly 10 seconds, which is very unique.
Scientists from all over the world, in fields from astrophysics to material science to biology, come to this tower to experiment with near-zero gravity. Because without the effect of gravity, flames can turn into spheres, strange states of matter appear, and things can just get really interesting.
The Bremen Drop Tower was developed and built 30 years ago.
Professor Hans Rath, the founder of ZARM, and Manfred Fuchs had the idea and saw the future of Bremen in space sciences and industries.
To build a lab that can consistently recreate the conditions of weightlessness, ZARM engineers have to eliminate the effect of gravity.
Gravity is a fundamental force which is acting on all kinds of matter. Gravity cannot be eliminated, but the effect can be eliminated by dropping experiments in free fall. And freely means without any external force acting on the experiment while dropping.
We are using a vacuum chamber to avoid air resistance during the free fall.
And a capsule that can reach velocities up to 165 kilometers per hour.
Micro in microgravity means that the quality that we are achieving is 1/1,000,000th of Earth's gravity. Everyone can experience microgravity by simply jumping off of something. As long as the velocity is small and the air resistance is small, the quality of weightlessness is quite high. Drop towers have several advantages compared to other microgravity facilities. Other facilities might be sounding rockets, satellites, space stations, and also parabola flight on planes. The big advantage of drop towers is the accessibility and the repeatability. If one experiment failed, you just try again. On other platforms, this normally is far too expensive.
The tower runs roughly 250 days a year with up to 3 drops per day. Depending on the experiment, scientists can choose between 2 different flight campaigns. First is drop mode, a straight free fall for 4.7 seconds of microgravity.
Here we are at the tip of the tower in 120 meters height. While the experiment is still hanging, every motion of the drop tube is leading to a rotational motion of the drop capsule, which again would lead to centrifugal forces during flight time, which we want to avoid.
So if you watch closely,
what you can see here is the effect of mechanical decoupling. The outer structure is moving, but the inner structure of the vacuum chamber is almost still. The mechanical decoupling of the drop tube allows us to drop experiments even at high wind loads as we have today.
The second drop style at the tower utilizes a special catapult system.
We are just entering the catapult cellar, 12 meters below the vacuum chamber. The catapult mainly consists of the tube and the piston, the pressure tanks and the hydraulics below. The great advantage is that we can double the microgravity time to nearly 10 seconds. Without the catapult, a normal drop tower would have to be 500 meters high to achieve the same time. Before each catapult flight, the experiment capsule is lowered to this point. Here it is standing for a while, and when shot, these 6 valves are opened within 0.2 seconds, and several hundred liters of oil are rushing through these tubes. It is accelerated with 30 G, 30 times Earth's gravity, to fly its vertical parabola.
And believe it or not,
the whole catapult system is not standing on the ground, but hanging on the ceiling. This was necessary to be able to fine adjust the catapult to optimize the flight path of the drop capsule.
Experiments range from fundamental physics like quantum mechanics up to more applied sciences like fire safety devices on space stations. Today we have a very interesting experiment in our drop tour.
Yeah, I'm working now in granular matter sciences. And my position is a researcher at the German Center for Aerospace Research in Cologne.
I would like to develop new measurement methods to analyze sand remotely on moon on asteroids, because we cannot just dig a sample, bring it here and investigate it.
Right now we are refurbishing the experiment. We circulate water through a sample cell and measure light scattering properties.
Light scattering is exactly what it sounds like. Shining a light on a sample and measuring how fast it fluctuates to reveal a material's inner structure. Dr. Born and his team can leverage this technique to reveal the dynamic motion of particles on planetary surfaces one day. But to get there, they have to start with something a bit simpler, like water.
This tower is for us the only place on Earth where air bubbles and sand particles move in the same way because they're not affected by gravity. So we had the last days some problems with the experiment routines. We checked until late night and it worked properly. So I think we have good chances that we have a good day for good experiments.
The experiment capsule has a diameter of 80 centimeters and is between 1.5 and 2.5 meters long. At the bottom, we have a battery pack and a service module, which is a computer to automate the experiment and to log the data. The possibilities range from simple temperature or pressure sensors up to high-speed cameras with up to 1,000 frames per second. And the rest of the volume and space is left for the experiment.
What you can see from here is the piston, the big black piece of carbon fiber. The experiment is placed on top of the piston, standing on just this small space.
Once the experiment capsule is installed, pumps switch on to suck the air out and create a vacuum.
These are our vacuum pumps. We are just starting to evacuate our drop tube. This will take about 90 minutes before we can drop the experiment or shoot the catapult.
We want to create scattering from spherical air bubbles. And today we hope to see for the first time that they really form perfect spheres in microgravity. We are ready to fly. So I would ask Lisa now to set up everything in action.
3, 2, 1, und Pumpe aus.
Wow, cool. Die stehen wirklich da drin. Das war cool. Guter Flug. Es hat alles geklappt. Great, high five. So we saw in the live video from our sample cell that we had air bubbles in the cell and they really stopped flowing.
Such that you have no buoyancy anymore, basically, so they just stop and you can have a look at them while you're in microgravity. And this is what we were actually aiming for, so it worked. And we are very excited about that. If we have a working setup, we can change some parameters. On different planets, you have different gravity intensities. If we are able to show how things work in microgravity, we might draw conclusions to different gravity regimes at some point.
If you want to investigate the soil on Mars, you have to have a method that can remotely investigate packing density or flow behavior. All the rovers we sent to space so far, they went at some point to a so-called stationary operation mode because they just got stuck in sand. So it would be really great to have a sensor in front of the rover which measures is the sand starting to flow, and then we can say stop, no, we cannot drive on that sand, we need to drive somewhere else. We start with something simple and then we successively increase complexity and see that we can take the theory along.
After the flight, the capsule entered the deceleration container here, and then we reflooded the drop tube for about 30 minutes, fished for the experiment, and now we are taking it out again. Even though the deceleration container is 8 meters in height, it takes approximately 3 meters to decelerate the capsule from 140 kilometers per hour to zero. The cone shape of the capsule limits the deceleration to up to 40 G to shield the experiments from too hard accelerations.
And also to help break the capsule's fall.
The deceleration is achieved using tiny polystyrene balls. The noise that you are hearing is the recycling of our polystyrene balls. which were compacted by the deceleration of the experiment. We are sucking the polystyrene balls out at the bottom and lifting them up to the top again and throw them in again. Now the experiment is opened and the outer shell is removed, which remains in the drop tube. And the experiment is handed over again to the scientists to prepare the next flight.
The existing Bremen Drop Tower is limited in repetition, mainly by the time that it takes to evacuate this 1,700 cubic meters of air out of the drop shaft. We've been asking scientists what they need and what they would want for future drop towers, and they said 100 times more experiments per day.
What I'm standing on is our new Gravity Tower Bremen, which is actually under construction.
The idea of this new kind of drop towers is that we avoid the vacuum chamber by putting a slider around the experiment, which allows us to repeat experiments all day long.
We hope to take it into normal operation at the end of this year, then open to scientists from all over the world.
Giving scientists an even more efficient portal to microgravity will create new opportunities to test ambitious space hardware and speed up the pace of scientific discovery, one drop at a time.